I finished my PhD in space science around 2 years ago, and I really want to share some of the findings from that. I already made a video about why I wouldn't recommend doing a PhD and why I had a relatively bad experience, so I won't talk about that here anymore, but if you're interested, you can find that video linked somewhere here, probably, or in the description. If you just want to see the most interesting results and you don't really care about the methodology or the background, then you can skip ahead to the time on your screen. Just quickly, most of you watching this are not subscribed, so please subscribe if you want to see more space science and other videos. There's a cat just there who may or may not move around. Okay, let's get into it. So the title of my thesis was this, which is quite a mouthful, but basically it just means that I was looking at how to use seismic exploration, which we already use plenty here on Earth for other things like oil and gas exploration, to better understand other planetary bodies like the Moon, Mars, and asteroids. Seismic is the measurement of sound waves traveling through the ground to generate 2D or 3D maps of what it looks like down there, and to infer what materials are there. Passive seismic is the measurement of naturally occurring sound waves like earthquakes, but that wasn't my focus. I was looking at active seismic, which involves a man-made source, like a vibrating truck or even just an explosion. We don't do this last one as much today for obvious reasons, but it's still used sometimes. So why does understanding the interior of these planetary bodies matter? Well, in the case of an asteroid, if we wanted to deflect it from hitting Earth, it actually matters quite a bit. Just by observation, we can't tell whether an asteroid is solid or a rubble pile, for example. But each of these structures would require quite a different deflection strategy. And with seismic, we can find out which one it is. Other uses for seismic include understanding the internal structure and geomechanical properties of different off-Earth bodies if we ever wanted to mine them, colonize them, look for ice, or just understand how they were made for general science purposes. So we have done some seismic studies on the Moon, on Mars, and on Venus, but I really wanted to drill down on understanding exactly what is the difference between doing seismic surveys on the Earth and on these other planetary bodies, and how do these differences impact the results. Some of these differences include lower gravity in the case of most planetary bodies, especially asteroids and comets, which have basically none, different atmospheric pressure, which again for most small planetary bodies other than Earth, pretty much none, and different surface materials than we would typically find here on Earth. So how do we test how our equipment is going to work in these environments without actually going there? Well, gravity is probably the hardest one to replicate. The most practical way would be to go on a parabolic jet, which flies up and down just so, to recreate either a zero gravity environment or a low gravity environment. But these are pretty expensive, and just to get flight time for a few hours on one of these is about $40,000 to run some experiments. Atmospheric pressure we can test in a vacuum chamber, which I did at the Jet Propulsion Laboratory, part of NASA in the US. And for the surface materials, we can use manufactured versions of these called simulants. I want to talk a little bit more about these simulants because they're actually really cool. Lunar soil is obviously super rare and hard to get your hands on, even for research, and we don't have any Mars soil at all. So how do we do these tests in a realistic way? Researchers have studied the chemical properties of lunar and Mars soil and found samples here on Earth that closely match. They then sorted their grain size distribution to get something that was pretty similar. A lunar regolith simulant, ALRS-1, was manufactured at UNSW using basaltic soils from northern Sydney, Australia, and a Mars regolith simulant, MMS, was manufactured at JPL by crushing basaltic boulders. Other researchers have done other things with these regolith simulants. For example, some researchers at UNSW tested making bricks out of ALRS-1 to see if we could use them for construction on the Moon. The dust particles are pretty small. Most of the grains were smaller than 0.004mm wide. That's generally much smaller than anything you'd find on Earth, which is why the astronauts had trouble with it being so abrasive. So we had to wear dust masks when handling and testing. One of the main things we're interested in when we do seismic surveys is the speed at which sound travels through the material. That then tells us something about its properties and structure. So to do that, we bought a piezoelectric transducer, which can produce sound waves of a certain frequency and then measure them at a separate point once they've passed through the material. By knowing the distance between the source and receiver, you got your velocity. This would typically be used to look for flaws in construction, but it suited our purposes for a small-scale seismic experiment. So we made a steel box, filled it with regolith, put the source and receiver in, and away we went. The vacuum chamber tests were a little different. We filled the vacuum chamber with Mars regolith and then fed the cables through B and C ports and pumped the pressure down to 3% of Earth's atmosphere, which is the lowest we could get to. Mars atmospheric pressure is 1% of Earth's, so we didn't quite get all the way there, but we got close enough that we figured we'd be able to tell whether atmospheric pressure was making much of a difference. So what did we find? Well, we got measurements for the seismic velocity of lunar regolith that were pretty close to the in-situ velocity, which means in its natural environment on the Moon. So that was pretty encouraging. At the time, we didn't have anything to compare the Mars results to, but a few months after my thesis was accepted, the InSight lander team published their findings and found that P-wave velocity of the near-surface regolith was about 119 meters per second, plus or minus a bunch. So kinda close, I guess? I mean, not totally inconsistent. So what about the effects of compaction? Well, the results were pretty inconsistent. Sometimes the velocity was a little higher when we compacted it, sometimes it was a little lower. Now, the general understanding, of course, is when you compact something, it gets denser, and that should increase the size and velocity. But that wasn't very clear here. So keep that in mind, and I'll come back to that. When we ran the tests in the vacuum chamber, we didn't expect the atmospheric pressure to actually have that much of a difference on the velocity, if any. But as the pressure approached the lowest we could go, the velocity did drop. In fact, as we were testing the seismic velocity of air in the chamber as a calibration, it started off at 343 meters per second at Earth pressure, which is as expected, that's the speed of sound in air, but it stayed roughly the same before rapidly dropping at around 10% of Earth's atmospheric pressure. So if we're only measuring the seismic velocity of the soil grains, we'd expect the atmospheric pressure to not make any difference on the measurement. A hypothesis we came up with for the compaction and vacuum chamber results was that we weren't only measuring the seismic velocity of the soil after all. Here is a model we developed to possibly explain what we're seeing. So imagine a sound wave traveling from A to B. It can go along the grains through their contact to each other or through the air pathways between the grains. Now, normally, the velocity of most soil on Earth is higher than the velocity of air, 343 meters per second again, so the quickest path is normally along the grains. But these regoliths have unusually low seismic velocity, so in this case, the fastest path might actually be, at least partially, along the air pathways. This would explain why taking most of the air out reduces the velocity measurement. It would also explain why compaction has inconsistent results, because it reduces the amount of air in the soil, which cancels out the effect of compaction, which normally increases velocity. Now, why do the Lunar and Mars regoliths have such low seismic velocity? We found that the velocity increased with increasing grain size of the sample, which is in contrast to most of the literature saying that the grain size shouldn't affect the velocity of a sediment. So maybe this only holds true for sediments we find here on Earth with larger grain sizes, but that relationship breaks down as we get smaller and smaller in environments we'd only see off planet. But why do they have such small grain size? The best explanation for this is just that other planetary bodies have different weathering processes to here on Earth. For example, micrometeorites impacting the surface of the moon or an asteroid are going to break up those particles into even smaller pieces. I don't really think our data was sufficient to prove any of this because it was an accidental finding and we weren't really intending to look for it. But it is an exciting area for a future researcher, I think. Before you click away, I want to share something kind of personal, and I promise I won't do this too often. I'm currently unemployed and looking for work, but I'm finally giving this whole YouTube thing a proper go, and I'm working pretty hard to try and make interesting videos for you. If you'd like to support my work, you can definitely do that by liking this video, commenting on it, sharing it, subscribing, and I'd appreciate that. But I'd also like to ask you to consider making a small contribution on my Buy Me a Coffee page, and you can find the link for that below. This will help me potentially make this work a side hustle, if not my main hustle one day. So I think that's where I'll leave you today. I hope you enjoyed that deep dive into my PhD research. I found it surprisingly enjoyable to think about this after a few years. I guess maybe I'm finally healing from the pain of doing a PhD.